There are 450 entries here. Between them, they define Europe's biggest city. And that is the only way to do it, because London as a single personality simply does not exist. It never has, at least from the moment when Edward the Confessor built his abbey on the marshes, a couple of miles away from the original homogeneous commercial city. All the attributes of the capital have piled onto this shallow basin of gravel, like rugby players in a scrum, kicking and elbowing each other out of the way. And now with the pace of building hotted up, and all the second degree consequences working themselves out, the flood of the office workers is one, the flood of tourists is another, central London has disintegrated. Units like the City or Fleet Street may still mean something, but by pushing out all the quiet human spaces, the planners and speculators have removed the only mortar which could bind them together. London is indeed a thousand villages. Remove them, and all that's left is a vast hulk peppered with spectacular buildings, quaint occasions, false sophistication, and too many people in the underground.
This is About Buildings and Cities, a podcast about buildings and cities. I'm George Gingell.
I'm Luke Jones.
I'm Matthew Roberts.
We continue to talk about Ian Nairn, now getting to Nairn's London, his great guide to the capital.
And it's a famous little book. It has a big red Routemaster double-decker bus on the front cover. And it is exactly as he describes, a selection of buildings chosen rather idiosyncratically and described in a totally, inimitable way. Many very memorable descriptions of the buildings which he thinks are interesting and worth visiting. We should say at the beginning that he imposes quite a rigid selection process, where I think he won't review any building that you have to pay to get into, which is a good one. He has no sense of there being a sort of list of important things that ought to be covered. He does naturally cover a lot of the most famous buildings in the city, but he doesn't feel bound to talk about any ones that he thinks are boring, and also picks up on all sorts of ones. The mind darts immediately to Romford Market Square, that you would think would rank like fairly far down the list of London sites.
In some ways, it's a weird shadow of a Pevsner guide. It is like Pevsner, lots of entries for buildings or sometimes places. Like Pevsner, it covers everything and it's geographically organised. But the selection is based on several strange criteria, one of the key ones being things mostly that he likes or something he found interesting. And in other ways, it's a bit like a guidebook. It's kind of, in that way, trying to show you the good things of London, except that it shows you the things for the entire city. So not many guidebooks to London will have significant sections on, well, various of the outlying districts, really. I mean, Croydon or Eltham or Bromley or Brent, I wouldn't think feature in the Blue Guide or whatever.
The other crossover it has with the Pevsner guides, in Pevsner guides, you have these things called ambulatories, right, which are walking paths round cities where Pevsner chooses a route and then lists the buildings as you go along the route. And exactly the same way, the chapters in this book are arranged by kind of a series of picturesque walks from one iconic place to another.
With Nairn, you always get however he did it, or however it made sense for Nairn to view. So with Outrages, it's a car journey. This is him exploring London. You can't explore London in a car. It's like everything is close together, and a car is, you miss everything. Paris is basically like a succession of holiday trips, and then the towns is like, he kind of goes to the town and then picks out things again on a sort of strange route that you can't kind of work out how it works.
So yeah, we should say in this episode we're going to be talking about Nairn's Paris, which is his identical, methodologically similar somewhat, guide to the city of Paris, and then Changing Towns, which is a series of initially newspaper articles and then later a book about
It was in The Listener, which was the BBC's like culture and current affairs magazine, which originally mainly published transcripts of radio broadcasts, but it was meant to be the kind of highbrow version of the Radio Times, I think.
Well, there's a funny synergy there, because I didn't mention it in the last episode, but Outrages got turned into a BBC radio broadcast narrated by Hugh Casson, who's this sort of establishment architect of a modernist bent.
But we're going to get back to London, the great guidebook. And this is a city that, in spite of his various affectations to be from and about other places, he's a Londoner, kind of like us at the moment. Anyway, it's something that he's really speaking from experience, and he has settled, although I think he's done a series of trips to look at the things, he has settled opinions and knowledge about all this stuff to start with.
A lot of what is memorable about the book, it has to do with the way in which the buildings themselves are described. I mean, there are other things about it, kind of things about the approach, some of which we talk about in our when we were walking around reading it together. But I guess the most memorable thing for me is this sort of unique way of talking about and describing architecture, which is very vivid, very kind of characterful. But would it be good just to pick out a few little moments to give a bit of colour?
The way that he describes the kind of animated character of buildings. Buildings are constantly hunching over or towering above you or, you know, shrinking back, panting like Labradors. The buildings are kind of animated and characterful in a way that's brought out by his prose style.
Yeah, there's a description of the tower of the columns on the Tower of St. Martin Ludgate clanking into the central space from the corners.
Yeah, there's often motion.
There's often motion, and there's often a lot of, like, they're very concise sometimes. He talks about Herbert Baker's terrible travesty visited on top of Sir John Soane's Bank of England. It describes as an evil superstructure, I think he calls it.
Yeah, with very few exceptions, the entries are short. Typically, significantly less than a paperback page. There are a couple of long ones. There's a fairly long one for Westminster Abbey, which is a couple of pages long. But often, rather, as we illustrated last time with, or Matt did, with entries from Surrey, there can just be a few words bring something together. And those words will describe something, quality and character, but without often lots of detail, unless he thinks it's a particular thing that is particularly unusual and noteworthy. He also, I'd forgotten he did this, and he does this in Paris as well. He tells you in advance that everything is going to be good, except sometimes he's included a few bad things, and he puts square brackets around those so that you know before you read them that he doesn't like them. That's a kind of charming way of doing a guide, where you kind of bracket out stuff that is important to say, but not important to see. It's, like, pretty consistently good writing. It's very fun. It's very fun to read. It's less fun to try and read from cover to cover. It's lovely to just, you can open up any page and it will say something interesting, often about either, for me, somewhere familiar, in which case it's kind of like, oh, I can reinterpret it. If I've got a vision in my head, it kind of livens the description in that way. And then if I don't have a vision in my head, it sort of makes you want to go there, although doesn't, I would say, give you a particularly good idea of what it's like.
We spend an evening walking around the West End of London with a copy of the book. And so over the course of this episode, I'm going to seamlessly chop in bits and pieces of those kinds of descriptions. So I guess I'm telling you, listener, now that you're going to hear the conversation fade in and out, and you'll find yourself on a very warm and sunny, what was it, April evening?
Yeah, almost the only one
since
then.
Yeah, it's been pure rain.
Relentlessly rubbish weather.
We picked the right day. He's always interested in the design choices of the formal construction. That's always a guiding principle, but it's not the only thing that he's interested in, right? This isn't just a guidebook that describes the formal qualities
and
of the buildings.
And it also doesn't just describe buildings. It describes pointedly views, which often come with how you get to the view, which is idiosyncratic and charming, and also reflects, I think, a way that a delight can come across you when you're exploring a place. You know, you suddenly are struck by some sort of accidental composition in front of you. And he also describes, in generality, places. I was just distracted by looking at his description of Croydon Town Centre. So I'm not going to read the whole thing. There's two paragraphs. The first one basically describes the train station and all the commuters, and that the main train station is that the main station is called East Croydon, not Croydon. It's a peculiarity. Second, the astonishing growth of tall office blocks in the last 5 years. Even the rebuilt deserts of central London have nothing like this wholesale transformation of rather staid Victorian lumps into rather shoddy modern boxes. Whatever the result, the flux itself is exciting. And there is potentially a magnificent new city waiting to be expressed here. Accidental clues to it can be picked up in the way the new blocks crowd around the Victorian Church of St. Matthew in George Street near the station. That's the whole description.
That comes in a specific moment in the 60s that, right, where limits on building heights and planning for new office blocks in the square mile of the City of London... And prior to the creation of Canary Wharf as a kind of external financial district, there's this brief period of about 10 years where everyone thinks all of the big multinational corporations are going to build their headquarters in Croydon.
I think on de Gaulle's only visit to London as President of France, he visited only the city and Croydon, because I think they were thinking about what to do about La Défense. So there was a grand ceremonial... visit, but it what you get there is also he says they're kind of rubbish, and they are kind of rubbish, the towers of Croydon, but he isn't completely pessimistic about what the eventual outcome might be. He says rather rubbish Victorian buildings have been replaced by rather rubbish modern buildings, but there might be something fun to come.
Yeah, it might be exciting if they make enough of them.
And that's where he's different from pure young fogey. He's not pure reactionary.
There is an open-mindedness about the sort of potential excitement of just things sort of piling up on top of each other. Mediocre things in great profusion, but in a sort of exciting volume.
And contrasted with the best bits of the old fabric that have been retained. Shall I read a little bit of Nairn and we can...
Why do we do St Martin's in the Fields, which I guess is the oldest building on Trafalgar Square, isn't it? That was 1730s.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Like, I would say everything here is from the 19th century, isn't it?
Which we talked about we made reference to in the Hawksmoor episode, if you want a bit more context of it.
And I guess the one thing to say about it is that it's quite iconic in the sense that it served as a model for a huge number of churches that were built in America in the 18th century. Yeah. Like, if you think of the archetypal 18th century American church, yeah. Greek temple with a massive spire tower coming out of the middle of the roof.
You say massive, but the only thing I think is, like, possibly over-proportioned. I would say everything feels slightly under-proportioned, except for the enormous royal crest. In the pediment, which feels really big, but everything else feels like it's like the thing, it's big, but it somehow manages to feel slightly small.
I'll read from Nairn. So, that the British have a genius for compromise may be a commonplace, but to have a genius for anything is very special, and this particular brand is exactly what Gibbs had. Compromise, not as a deadening average, but as a positive thing. A balance of tensions runs all through St. Martin's. Italian license and native sobriety are exactly matched, not mechanically or intellectually, but out of the nature of man. Every stage of the steeple is a natural balance.
This is Nairn at like the platitudinous end, isn't it? It's sort of, I think that he gets to the heart of what is singular about it as a building, which is this peculiar maneuver of taking a Greek temple and putting a big steeple in the middle of it, which because it's so like absolutely normalized, and you know, it's so absolutely like paradigmatic for what a neoclassical church looks like, people don't really look at it and say that was quite a strange thing to do, and the effect is still quite peculiar if you really think about it.
Yeah, I think it was a mistake. I think every building based on it has somehow adopted that mistake. I think he's done it definitely a good B. Yeah. It's a good B of a building, but with a weird...
I feel like this is one of the moments where Nairn is outlining something about Englishness, right? He has certain ideas about
mythic ideas.
You know, the reasonableness, the compromise,
Tolerance.
Does the building embody that? I feel like it does in a sense. George's criticism of it feels like a criticism of its compromisingness.
It's a compromise in the way that a camel is a compromise. Like, it's a kind of ungainly meeting of two incompatible ideas. I don't dislike that about it. I think that's rather fun. But I don't think it's a beautiful building. And I think that attempts to sort of describe it so... Like, fans sort of... Neoclassicism fans always sort of reveal themselves as being slightly ridiculous in the attempt to justify this particular manoeuvre, because it's not justifiable. I think it's a wonderful and sort of picturesque part of the city fabric, but I'm not sure that it's a... Like,
well, that's
an
because they can't go along with the idea. They cannot admit to the idea that classical architecture is something that's made up.
Well, yeah.
like everything else, in that... you know, all of the elements of it were made up by somebody, most of them more recently than they would like.
Where do you think that Italian, where's Italian license? I sort of do think there is something here, like the sort of funeral vases at the top with this rather extravagant sort of swirling scalloping at the top.
There's that scalloping up there. And...
feels like you could have an orgy around some of those.
There's another tick of Nairn's, which is like, writing the biography of the architect into the building, and he's saying like, oh well, I know James Gibbs went and studied in Rome for a bit. It's the kind of one pop fact that people know about James Gibbs, so I'm going to read that into it. Is it inflected with the Italian Baroque?
I think so. Yeah. I think it is inflected with the Italian Baroque. I actually think everything he says is something that you could make a case for. Like, nothing he says is obviously wrong. Like, we can... The things I've been saying about it are kind of takes on that. They're not... He hasn't made a mistake. I personally think he overrates it, but...
Yeah, I think so. And also, I don't like situating buildings like this in some sort of... in these, like, mythic platitudes about Englishness, but I guess we'll get enough of that.
One of his vices...
Yeah.
He's got vices associated with being a fogey, young and old, or young and middle-aged, which are like a strange instinctive defense of what he would consider to be a kind of traditional English values, no doubt continually under threat. He's attached to an idea of a kind of old England that he thinks is sort of gone and still fundamentally submerged, eternally present. Yeah. And likes to situate things in that context, which is a very partial view. Yeah. It's not the England of Hogarth.
No.
No, that's not an England of compromise. That's an England of taking things too far.
Did you see the... this is an aside, but did you see the Hogarth at the Soane?
I did, yes.
I just keep picking up on... So there's so many more details that I hadn't, like... like the people burning a Jew in effigy in the background, and all the Tories throwing bricks through the windows.
Yes, yeah.
Like, the more I look at this church, the more I like it. But I like it as a kind of capriccio, as a like.
That's because you have perverse taste. you like the wrongness of it.
It's a sort of absurd capriccio. It's reminding me more and more of James Stirling's Number One Poultry. Actually, the way in which it's sort of put together out of these like radically incompatible elements. I think it's great. I think it shows it's exactly what you need.
It's
what you need in the corner of a square.
The show is sponsored by Blue Crow Media. Blue Crow Media is an architectural publisher of, well, architecturally themed maps of cities, guides for visits, both literal and also of the mind. If you fancy... like Nairn, traipsing around some of the less known landmarks and more distantly spaced delights, they do a whole package of specifically London-focused guides. The London Trees, I think we've talked about on the show before. It's very nice. I can confirm that it has a very good selection. There's the London Tubes, bit of London brutalism. The form of the maps is that they've got a nice, very clean sort of graphic illustration sort of plan for you to wander around with. And then on the back, it's got photos and descriptions of a selection, very carefully and judiciously chosen, of things worth seeing. They're very nice, and they also make very good gifts. if your mind is turning that way. They're available on their website, bluecrowmedia.com, and if you do buy, use our offer code about buildings, all one word, you get 10% off. Thanks a lot to Blue Crow for sponsoring the show.
One of the properties of this book now is that it is a crystallisation of London in a very specific period of time, midway through transformation. As a guide to London now, in some ways it's rather unsatisfactory because most of the, or like a large chunk of the notable modern buildings haven't happened yet, but a large amount of the clearing has. It was all very new. You get this first impression of a lot of the buildings built in the 50s in London are and early 60s are often ones that we pass over because they seem so staid. They're part of the post-war reconstruction when a lot of stuff needed to be built, and often in a slightly utilitarian way, even prestigious buildings were often fairly staid, even if they're kind of well constructed, because they were shocking just being modern buildings in that cityscape. Whereas later expressions would have to try a little bit harder to be interesting, as things kind of go through the more expressive brutalist or high-tech iterations we'd get a bit later. So it kind of opens your eyes to that stuff. But I think, in a way, we have to encounter this world where, like, large chunks of the city... Like, when this book was written, there was still... Like, the parking was very easy in the city. All those... The bomb sites everywhere. And sure, they'd been tidied up, but they were covering the city for long after this, and it's a very different place that he's describing.
There's an incredible photo that I might try and put on the social media feeds of after... The 1951 Festival of Britain, right, which is the century on from the Great Exhibition in 1851. After all of those structures, the temporary structures were taken down, pretty much the whole of that site spends about 15 years as a car park. And there's amazing photos of the entirety of that, what is now like basically the footprint of the London Eye, if you were to lay it down on the South Bank.
The idea that they were temporary, I think, is slightly disputed. I mean, they weren't actually temporary. It's just that Churchill ordered them all to be knocked down because they were ideologically, you know, anathema to him.
The great contributions of Churchill's second term, which is that he managed to end rationing, reintroduced sort of the persecution of particularly gay men, and demolished the Festival of Britain.
Pure culture war. That was his priority. I'm not sure how temporary they were necessarily intended to be, but he made them very temporary. He does have a description of the festival hall, which isn't, I don't know if it's an interesting one or not.
It's not wholly positive. I could read it. The Royal Festival Hall, LCC, Architects Department, Special Works Division, 1948 to 50 and 63 to 64. The new facades will be complete by the time this book appears, and so the unsuspected tragedy has come full circle. The old elevations were an honest muddle. The new ones are a faceless smoothing over of dissension. The difference between the political climate of the 40s and that of the 60s. Why the muddle and why the smoothing over? Because this is the most terrifying example in London of the difference between statistical and artistic reality. The Festival Hall inside is acoustically perfect and musically dead, an epitome of all the occasions when a pattern of human behaviour has been given precedence over humanity itself. The Albert Hall is fallible and understandable, a vehicle for compassion. This, in its icy blind perfection, is unforgivable, and nothing will ever change it. Fiddle around with the front while London burns, if you like, but it won't do you any good.
That's funny, because now we think of it as being rather idiosyncratic, sort of 50s building, kind of weird, cute, slightly space-age details.
Sort of stately, it's a little staid, a little awkward, but very lovable. And very much of, yes.
And also having that terrible acoustic performance, which had to be rectified at great expense.
It's the opposite. It's the opposite. Everyone says that the sound is terrible. But the building is rather lovely and rather optimistic with these kind of, endlessly flowing open public terraces going up and up and up on the inside.
And very generous internal, like all the sort of landings and things are really big. And floaty.
It's always good to get a window onto how things seemed at different times.
And as we discussed in the episode, he's not that big on lots of the things that are regarded as classics. You know, he's not that great on the Economist building. I was reading the Golden Lane Estate, which I would say he's soft on rather than...
Yeah, I mean, one of the big transformations of the city throughout this period is building all of this modernist social housing in different styles and in different places, most of which he's pretty, at best, equivocal on. It's funny, the ones that he likes. The one that I thought he had the most positive description of all is like a totally featureless estate near Highbury Corner.
It's like he's quite positive about Churchill Gardens, which I struggle to be that enthusiastic about.
I found the one which I was thinking of, which is Highbury Quadrant, which is, it's like totally nondescript, five-story blocks. Anyway, he describes it thus. An estate from the vintage years of the LCC before it traded humanity for a change in architectural fashion and some tall slabs. Blocks of yellow brick, five-story flats, up close up to old trees, interspersed with two- and three-story red brick terraces. Delightful to walk through. A real melting together of buildings and landscape. A personal touch which runs through to the railings and paving. Which is sort of weird. I mean, it's funny. You get a sense of how much, like, I think a particular kind of fancy takes him at certain points. I think of this as a place which is...
Do you think he was just a bit drunk or something?
I think so, because I think that this for me is an estate which is, yeah, totally nondescript. They've got lots and lots of these all over the place. And also, I mean, apologies to anyone who lives there, but not very nice. Like, kind of boring and like a bit weird and quiet. And it has the kind of thing with blocks with sort of perimeter green, but not very much on then otherwise quite quiet Victorian streets.
It's really nice to have someone be willing to kind of slag stuff off in a guidebook. We don't have nearly enough of that. In fact, architecture media in general, it has like, this building is the most appalling thing ever, but it doesn't have a lot of like, this is a bit rubbish, should try harder. But he never says what, he says, oh, it could all have been great. Well, Ian? How? What is required other than brilliance? Like, yeah, I know more brilliance is nice. Down with the bad and all that sort of thing. Up with the good. But what? What do you want? But as a guidebook, reading... I'd far rather read something that's, like, wrong and said with some sort of spirit behind it than most guides to this sort of thing are not worth even thinking about to the extent that they even exist, which is pretty limited.
Oh, it does look rather nice in the sunlight. I mean, again, I kind of...
I mean, this is actually of its period of late modernism before high tech. This is probably the most famous one in London, isn't it?
So we're looking at the Smithsons Economist building, which is...
recently vacated by the Economist.
Yeah.
And now in the Adelphi.
Yeah, kind of famous. Actually quite a strange building.
It's a miniature cluster of skyscrapers, like super shrunk down, clad in Portland stone, full of fossils.
And it's located in like a sort of super exclusive but fun zone of St. Well, James's.
Well, because the magazines were in Clubland as well.
Yeah.
Very clubby places.
Yeah.
As in fact was, where was the AR? It's not that far from here.
Queen Anne's Gate, so over towards the parks.
Okay.
That's where the AR was operating.
Where should we be? How quickly are we going to get thrown out of here?
I don't know. That's a good question.
Yeah, I wonder.
We can go down
to the other corner.
And then be on the street.
Well, yeah.
I think this is a classic bit of pseudo-public space, isn't it?
Yes. Sure this is.
We can do our little reading as well.
Because Nairn talks about the relative accessibility of the plaza. That's the thing. We've got these three towers, one much bigger than the other two, and then a kind of raised up plaza level between all of them. So the Economist building, 23 to 27 St. James's Street, Alison and Peter Smithson, 1964. The buildings on this site may interest only the 1960s, for this is where the angriest of Britain's young architects were finally given their chance. It was 10 years in coming, and the time lag shows. but the space between the buildings is a permanent gain. At last, an architect has suggested, and a client allowed, that a highly valuable slice of W1 be treated imaginatively as part of London. Those who flat pave part of the site and put up a thumping slab on the rest are doing no better than the bad old cover-it-all boys. The L-shaped area contains three hexagonal towers, one medium and two small. In the angle of the L is a showy 18th century club, Boodles. The rest of the space is open to the public. This is Boodles, so there's a funny sort of...
What are we doing here, guys?
What's that? Doing a podcast.
Recording a podcast.
No, that's okay. It's all right. What's that?
Architecture.
Yeah.
yeah, so Boodles is this building on the left, and there's a funny moment where you have a kind of pseudo bay window built in the with the materials and the style of the rest of the office blocks, the Smithson, but extended into the side of the Georgian building of Boodles, but sadly now painted over grey, so it doesn't look like it's the same as the Portland Stone or the rest of the... Anyway, I'll finish reading it. It is not just open space. The levels enable you to squint out at a sloping St. James's Street, lord it over the side streets from under a colonnade, or just sit down on a stone bench. This is only the starting point for what could happen, like Whittle's first jet, and nothing much will come of this particular example unless some activity can be attracted or allowed into the central space. But the idea has an enormous potential. Here is a kind of Saint-Denis, no more accommodating and no less pregnant than that other prototype. So, I mean, for listeners there, he's saying, like, Saint-Denis, the first Gothic cathedral, or the first cathedral to be built with Gothic features. And here he's saying, this is the start of something new as
because
well.
Because of its elevated plinth.
Because of its elevated plinth.
Yeah, hollowing out the middle
of the lots of elevated plinths, although I feel they'd already been going for a while by this point.
I guess the attraction of this building, and it is... is the way, is that thing of creating this funny little internal space which feels like its own little hidden world and which is very much in, like, it's like a real time warp to a very, very specific moment in history.
But it's also, I think, just having a playful, like, collection of weird little shapes is kind of fun. It's an expensive way of building, but it's quite nice because you're left with little buildings, which are quite nice as well. They've got lots of light.
That was the Economist.
Yeah, that was the...
And this is the one that we're next to, is the one whose existence he regrets. He thinks it would have been nicer if this had all been a plaza here as well.
I think he's wrong.
Yeah, I think he's wrong about that too.
I think the plaza would have been Rubs.
Also, I don't think this is a very... I'm not convinced by the idea that this view is particularly, like, worth having. Like, being able to stand in there.
To be fair, that may not have been there.
No. God, that looks like a bit of Dimitri Porphyrios, doesn't it?
Someone of that ilk.
But his regret, which I think is something we'll pick up a lot in talking about him, is that there's potential here, but it's not being enlivened by activity.
Picturesque activity, cabbages, turkeys, jet engines. I think that there is a sort of...
When I first came here 20 years ago, it felt super sterile.
Yeah.
It's now got tables and drinkers in the middle of it, which is... But it felt like a piece of kind of industrial... Yeah. Sterile industrial machinery in the city.
Yes.
With a charming sculptural quality because of the buildings and a weird cut-off kind of isolated, desiccated square. Mm. And all the design is super crisp and crunchy and... like articulate and wipe clean and hard and cut up in like fine divisions of low relief.
Yes, and also done in this sort of strangely ancient seeming prestige material. You know, there are essentially like metallic details done in this fossil limestone, which is its effect. I mean, I remember being brought here as an architecture student and thinking, I don't really understand why this is a good building. And I can see it a little bit now. It is nice, the space. It definitely wouldn't work if you didn't have this Japanese restaurant with everyone drinking various
sorts
of cocktail.
But it also wouldn't work without the building in front, because it would not be separated from the traffic.
No, it would be...
Ian Nairn actually quite likes traffic. He likes sitting in traffic, but sitting in traffic is horrible.
I think one area in which he does lay out a vision of how things should be, and it's more about the kind of atmosphere and social life of the city that he wants to inhabit, right? He wants to be able to walk out of his door in his, you know, nice Georgian house in Pimlico, terraced house, and have lots of pubs in close proximity where he can go and then like a market that he can walk through on the way to the pub and go and do some writing in the pub over the course of an afternoon. And he wants to live in the social fabric of the city, and he wants architecture that encourages a kind of busyness, a commerciality, and it's Jane Jacobs kind of stuff, I guess, to a certain extent.
Yeah, vibrant city environment where I get the sense he's like kind of slightly like not lonely, but like person who spends a lot of time with himself or with a close group of people, not mega social, but loves the sort of parasocial qualities. I think the reason he works in a pub is he loves people kind of chatting, not to him, but like around him socially, and him being urban anonymity in a fun, jolly crowd of market buying and colourful various activities. Something he's always looking for as well is something which is particular. Anything that's particular about that place. Which I guess if you go looking around everything all the time, it's a bit like, you know, marking essays or whatever. Like, there's so many that are so similar, and then something sticks out. It becomes a real centre for him, and he's, oh, there's something different here. That is it, but he doesn't then really... Sure, that's something he likes. Not many people are against vibrant street life, good places to go.
No, I don't think he does, because I don't think he can get outside of... I mean, even more so than, you know, your everyday person. I think he's entirely, like, inside his own emotional response to things. I think it's something which he articulates quite nicely in the TV shows that... we'll talk about a bit later. You know, he talks about how this is what he likes to do instead of going to the football. He likes to go and wander around and look at buildings. And that's, he makes this kind of equivalence between some people like to go to a football match and watch the football match. And I like to go around and look at the buildings and absorb the buildings.
And that colours this. It's like him going to places and coming up with spirited senses of them. It's a process which brings him joy, and it's what he's trying to do. He is really hard on Dulwich Art Gallery. End of the first paragraph. So Dulwich is a great curiosity. It's not a masterpiece. Asterisk. Under the asterisk. If you don't agree and would like to look upon an opposing view, read Sir John Summerson's In Georgian London. It is one of the most incisive and brilliant descriptions of a building that has ever appeared in print. And that's someone who, like... That's a really charming thing to do. It's like he's saying this building is like, I don't understand it. It's been bashed up in the war. It's blank-faced and academic is what he's saying. You know, it's too clever by half. But you should read someone who really loves it. And it's this. And that's another quality that's really good, which is that he is a friend of good buildings. In general, he's, you know, willing to be open-hearted about it. And that's really appealing.
So we're coming up to pub now. First pub of the walk. Obviously, it being in Nairn, that is late because we should have started initially at a pub.
There's a bunch of them in the book. It's one, definitely one of its virtues is the care and attention given to the pubs and the loving way in which they're described.
And actually, as a building, that looks pretty good. It's now Fuller's.
I mean, the pubs are one of the best things about London, actually. Yeah. They're the one thing you really miss.
So, shall I start off by reading and then we can talk about it?
Yeah, do a little reading.
Okay. It's now closed for the... there's a virus going round.
Don't know if anyone's heard. So we're at the Red Lion, Duke of York Street. If I could keep only one pub out of the whole London galaxy, this would be my choice. It is not especially comfortable or especially atmospheric, but it strikes deeper than any other. All around the walls are magnificent cut glass mirrors, the best in London, recently renovated, so they gleam as sharply as they ever did. And as the bar space is roughly square, wall after wall after wall is reflected in the real walls, a process which, oddly enough, reinforces the solidity. Nothing is fuzzy, but everything has incredible depth and compassion, combined with brilliance. This is the opposite thing to the gentle, sentimental pub, where you can wash your troubles into oblivion. If you had a problem, the Red Lion could not ease it, however much you drank. Instead, it would strengthen you. It is a place to walk out of ramrod straight, reinforced by those proud, sparkling arabesques.
Couple pros there.
It's, yeah. Also, there's a point midway through where I'm like, I'm not quite sure I understand.
It was the Evening Standard Pub of the Year in 1971.
I wonder if drink was taken during the writing of that.
Undoubtedly. I mean, on a serious note, it does read like the prose of someone justifying a problematic
it reads like someone, when you're having an argument with someone who's a bit more drunk than you are, and you notice, but they don't notice, that the thing they're talking about changes halfway through what they're saying. but it does look nice. I mean,
let's go peer in the windows.
What did you ever take anyone to this one on your tour when you were doing the tour guiding?
I have been here exactly once on a tour. We didn't normally come this far west on account of there not being much actually to go to these days. It was quite late on in the evening, and so I was quite drunk.
They are nice.
They do have some non-Fuller's beer, which is always a good sign in a Fuller's pub.
And they are rather, you can see a little bit of the mirrors right up in the corner there, which are rather nice painted mirrors.
It's a square bar with a square bar room with a square bar in the middle of it.
Which I guess is a nice arrangement.
Which is nice, actually.
It's a nice arrangement, yeah.
Get a picture of the pub.
Lots of people who listen to the show won't ever have been to a proper pub.
Yeah.
They'll just have godless bars and restaurants.
I don't think
and
I can sum up what makes them like that.
They're a home from home, but
they're
not
social.
The way not the way that you would think.
Yeah.
They've got to have the right sort of
decor.
They're
neither for dangerous drinking nor hookup joints.
Yeah. They should have decoration which is sort of, in one sense, is very extravagant, but also doesn't really feel like it's making a lot of itself. Like the thing of having mirrors everywhere and having like very, very elaborately sculpted ceiling.
That's the pub of the late 19th century, the kind of post-gin palace.
Yeah, but his
golden age, certainly, which may be the golden age, is, yeah, probably like 1880 to 19, to the First War.
Yeah.
The First War was the greatest catastrophe for pubs that ever occurred.
Yeah. Yeah, how are you going to come back from that?
They all got nationalised, and the government went round as hard as it could, making them as crap as possible in order to try and persuade people to drink less.
Yeah.
They also insisted that no beer could be made, I think, above 3%, which had a lasting, terrible effect.
He wrote an article specifically about the pub. It's called Pub in Focus, which was in the Architectural Review. With very nice illustrations, I don't know who by, but I'll put bits from it up. So he says, and this connects because John Soane, who did the Dulwich Pitch Gallery, is like an abiding interest of his. In the Soane Museum, complexity of space is played with for its own sake. In a pub view, it corresponds to psychological levels and states of the imbiber. And the more he imbibes, the clearer do the levels get, up to the usual point of incapability. For a pub to have these levels is, in the end, as necessary to long-term drinking as good beer.
This is one of his great virtues. I mean, the great age of building pubs in London, I guess, is the age of its sort of most, greatest velocity of expansion, sort of from the 1880s to 1910s
That's certainly,
or something.
What I would say is the age of the greatest pub building, or certainly now. I mean, he's not talking about pubs as buildings. He's not super interested in like the old coaching inns, which some people would wax lyrical about. He's interested in about the good drinking pubs and the pubs which are good to drink beer in. And actually he is, I think, much more interested. I mean, he talks about good beer. I've seen pictures of him sitting in front of glasses that say like Indy Coombe or Double Diamond on them or any of this horrible crap. I think he's much more interested in this social and architectural setting than. Although, I mean, it was in a benighted era of kegization.
The thing that Pub in Focus thing gets to is, again, I guess the kind of intersection between his interest in formal analysis and, like, social experience, because he's really interested in the way that you... that pubs can provide different angles out on the street and that you have a kind of different gradations of access and familiarity with the people, other people in the pub. You can have different kind of interpersonal relations that are dictated by the design of the space. And so that's one of the things that he really likes is when...
They are unique spaces, pubs. Being abroad at the moment, one of the things people sort of ask about is what pubs are like, and it's interesting and difficult to describe the ways in which they are very distinctive and different from bars in other European cities. And some of those are to do with a sort of ethic, I guess, that they have this kind of weird sort of coziness, this kind of domestic, this sort of a mixture of like domestic elements and then also a bit of ostentatious luxury. But there are also spatial things, and which are to do with crew.
There's a lot of play about making big spaces into things the size of a sort of part of a living room. You know, they're not necessarily... I mean, they can be subdivided up into lots of little rooms, but more commonly, they're semi-divided. Because it's trying to create often this kind of... A lot of the time, this has been stripped out as well. There was a great tendency towards kind of trying to make them into big drinking halls for a while, trying to trick the brain as much as possible into thinking that you're in a fantastically opulent living room, but a very small one, with some of your most intimate friends in your fantastically opulent palatial front room, where everything is fantastically opulent until you look at it closely, which you don't because you are drinking. also, it's a perpetual sort of hopefully early or mid-afternoon evening in a kind of glow at their best that's created. And it can be... And he picks up on this, you know, he talks about the Blackfriars in Blackfriars as being having this spatial play, but it's too kitsch, like, which it is. It's all kitschy, and it pulls back from that. And then really enjoys some of the earlier, that's one I think built in the 1890s, late 1890s. And enjoying, or perhaps it's a couple of years later than that, enjoying pubs from a slightly earlier period in the kind of gin palace style, where they're incredibly opulent, but it's not trying to impersonate anything other than itself, really. He can make meaningful, good judgments about pubs. He does also like some of the flat... There's a couple of positive reviews about flat roof pubs in there, which I haven't got into. I haven't spent very much time in those places, and many of them haven't survived. In some of the films, he also, as we're talking about that, is quite positive about... when I say flat roof pubs, I mean post-war pubs built either in estates or as fill-in for ones that have been demolished in kind of...
Lillington Gardens, the pub on the corner of Lillington Gardens, he goes into in a film, which is a Pimlico housing estate.
In the film, it does not appear to be a cut above. I couldn't recommend that one to someone... based on anything other than the convivial atmosphere it does manage to capture. But and it's lovely to have someone kind of engage with them. He does review them properly. And he does say bad things. He'll call them out. I have recently experienced the onward march of chainization in a number of the local pubs, and it's a tragedy when you've got this like beautiful skeleton of a really good pub which is now inhabited by a faceless corporation.
Oh yeah, that's terrible.
I feel things have slid continuously downwards in the quality of pubs. The quality of beer has improved quite a bit. The quality of pubs since then, I mean, and it had been sliding already for quite some time before its time. I think we've lived through a century or so of serious decline. It's a battle. Yeah, particularly if one's with, where the, it is both a beautiful building, but also run kind of well and sensitively.
Vanishing number. Very few
of those left in the city, and they're growing scarcer by the day around here.
Down with this sort of thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Strongly. Do we want to talk a little bit about what's happened to this book and like its current reception, or do we want to talk about that somewhere else?
It was very well received at the time, right? It ran to quite a few, couple of editions.
Yeah, I had a few editions in the 60s, in the early 70s. And it starts to become a bit out of date in the kind of mid to late 70s. Like, it's no longer a review of contemporary London. Like, London's moved on a lot then, and it's starting to feel a bit... And you probably could still get it in paperback quite easily. And I think that's something that affects his work generally, that at one point it had a great contemporary meaning and it's part of the dialogue of what's going on at that point. And then it's not, and it's old news. But this book was a popular book and it had a good reissue a little after his death. He died pretty young. The pubs didn't help. In the 80s, which had an update... And put in a lot of the buildings that were missing. I don't know who wrote it, which has now disappeared. It had a different, had a sort of picture postcard quartered front. That's the one my dad's got, I think. Which you can sort of see what the problem was at that time, which is that it was horribly out of date. And so what they did was they got someone to write a load more entries. And he becomes pretty obscure, I would say, a pretty obscure figure in the 90s and early 2000s. Obviously all the people are still around, but in an era where he's a newspaper journalist, newspaper journalism is incredibly ephemeral. He writes in magazines. These are probably the things that most of his output goes to. And to an extent, the books are kind of collations of a lot of that work. And then he's in television, which before the internet was also incredibly ephemeral. And then... really in the last 10 years, probably to the dawn of sort of people being on the internet, people starting to discuss him, he's starting to be figured as a figure from history, a figure from the great post-war culture wars in architecture, and it's kind of revivified on that. And I think Nairn's London was the first one to come. People were talking about, oh, this book's been out of press. I think there's an edition in the 80s. There's an edition at the beginning of the 2000s. There's never out of press for more than about 10 years. 10 or 12 or something. But they're all a bit half-hearted compared to what's happened now, which is, now we've got one, which is, you can see the changing taste, an exact copy of the first one. rather than a facsimile, it's what you do to, you know, William Blake's poems or whatever. A complete recreation of the document as it was.
Exactly as it was, yeah. And it's accompanied, as you've alluded to there, by, like, YouTube. And suddenly someone digs all the recorded VHSs out and puts the videos of his TV performances up. He has an idiosyncratic charm.
Yeah, we'll talk about the videos in the next one, definitely. But in terms of the book, a lot of people have this book. He was someone who I hardly read. My dad has now given me two copies of Nairn's London, inadvertently. Something he's done with two... He gave me two copies of Norwegian Woods, and he's given me two copies of Nairn's London. I don't know what that says. But I kind of regarded it as something sort of fogyish and 60s-like, and I think I'd slipped into the prejudice that lots of people... that he was maybe an interesting figure of the past, not something desperately relevant to me. And I also thought it was something that was really, like, commonly known, like Kenneth Clark's Civilization, or...
Also not that commonly known, I think.
Yeah, but cultured English people will know it. And I think actually it vanished much more. You, Luke?
I'm not sure. I don't know when I first read it. I mean,
I didn't read it very much before we decided to do this show. I guess I'd probably just been aware of people writing essays about him because he's sort of cropped up here and there.
Because you're on the interwebs.
Well, also, but you know, he also pops up in like the liberal press generally. I feel like I've read about him, and it's good. It's definitely been rewarding. It's always nice to read someone who's good at writing about architecture.
Just very few of them.
Yes. Good at describing buildings, actually, is the main thing.
There's not much of this stuff about. Matt, for you, it's clearly something you're interested in.
Yeah, totally. I mean, I think that I discovered him when I was first getting into architecture. When you start to get interested in architecture, there's a language problem, which is you're starting to look at buildings, but you don't necessarily naturally know the language of the kind of, you know, formal analysis of like Pevsner.
I just said, you know, you're the person who knows all the names of all the twiddly bits on the outside of a building.
I try to, but also,
I don't know any architects who know that stuff.
Also, Nairn is someone who doesn't feel the need to go through all the specific fiddly names for all the proper nouns for the bits and bobs, but he does have this incredible like literary poetic ability to conjure something about compositions that isn't always right, but is always vivid and always like draws your attention to something about it that you hadn't seen before. In a dry sense, all of my like academic work has been basically about language and architecture, and about like how people in different historical periods have tried to use language to describe or convey something about their built environment. And then I think he's one of the all-timers for that. And that's why I wanted to do him, because I just think there's very few people who write about architecture for whom we could just like dive into the book in a recording like this and kind of drop a random, like any description.
Yeah, I would say actually you could read anything in Nairn's London and talk about it. It would be like acceptable quotation on, which is, oh my God, so untrue
rare.
For most
so
of
the rare. He's just...
Yeah, it doesn't require much interpretation. It's just, you know, rather like the book itself, the appreciation is aesthetic.
Yeah, he conveys passion.
Which is good, because when you feel passionate when you're looking at a building, it's really nice to have someone like Ian standing over your
shoulder.
You're
overtaken by, yes.
You know, sharing in the vibes. That's my feeling. I absolutely have like an emotional connection to him that is extremely wet.
Cool. Yeah, keep yourself to single digit pints of an evening. Yeah. if you can't count, it's too many. It'd be fine.
If it's more than one, it's probably too many for me at my time of life.
Firstly, I know that to be desperately untrue. Secondly, you have a strong legacy to live up to.
So, thanks again for tuning in and listening. Yeah, you will have been hearing excerpts from our site visits with Ian over our shoulder in this episode. If you want to hear the whole thing, including us being sworn at by members of the public, come over to Patreon, where I'm going to upload the whole block of our wanders around. Come listen on, subscribe to the Patreon through the link in the show notes, and you'll be able to hear the joys.
Good. And yeah, thanks a lot for listening. And we'll be with you again very soon.
Bye bye.
Good night. Bye bye.
Night. Bye.
I'm at my office desk, one of them. This pub's in the bottom of the Lillington Street estate. Was put in and designed by the same architects. I think they've made a very good job of reinterpreting the essence of an English pub without loading it with Victoriana. And I find that 3/4 of an hour in a pub like this, I can work much better than I can in my home or my office where the telephone's ringing all the time. This kind of background buzz of conversation gives a real internal privacy. I doubt if half a dozen people in Pimlico know where I am today. That's marvellous. It doesn't mean it's indifferent. There's friendliness there. It's not the trumpeted indifference of big cities, not the thing that happens in all but a very few streets in New York, for example. And I think the real reason is that this is a village inside the city. It's got the best of both worlds. And this, for me, is exactly what city living, living in Pimlico, is. If I had to sum up how to make a village inside the city, one or two obvious things like no through traffic, but also no colossal absence of traffic, no vast arrangement to take everything out of it and leave all the vitality out. But most of all, a mixture of people and uses and attitudes and temperaments, all rubbing along together, not segregated, not set up as one half being workers and one half being professionals, men and women or anything else, just people working together, acting together, making a place together, and not trying too hard to do it, not uptight about it. That's Pimlico for me, and London.